I'm going to start with a very long bio.
Yes. No. Yes.
I'll just summarize so that you understand that the prominence of, in case you don't already know. So we are really lucky to have today Dr. Monica R. McLemore, who is a tenured professor in the Child, Family, and Population Health Department and the interim director for the Manning-Price Spratlan Center.
I'm permanent now. That's so good.
All right.
Permanent now.
She's the permanent director for the Manning-Price Spratlan Center for Anti-Racism and Equity in Care in Nursing at the University of Washington School of Nursing.
Yeah.
And before that, she was a tenured associate professor at UCSF and the Thelma Shobe Endowed Chair.
Yes.
And she had was a, in clinical practice as a public health and staff nurse for 28 years.
Mm-hmm.
And her research and advocacy and presence is around reproductive health and justice. That is, includes spanning from scholarly articles to public press to amicus briefs to answering the phone to people who call her.
Yes, right.
Camping out in my office.
I was talking to Danielle Jones from AWON.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I love her.
And she's a fellow of the American Academy of Nursing. She's the editor-in-chief of Health Equity Journal, where many of us publish and attempt to publish. Mm-hmm. And we are just thrilled to have you here. So we've got a lot of people online. And great waving, and a lot of people in the room, even though we have a reproductive health event in Washington at the same time. So,
and I'm running back for the reception, so there's a training back.
So, I have about 5 questions. This is going to be super casual. And if you, I know we've talked about the questions before, but if you want to answer something different,
okay,
feel free.
You know, I'm gonna do that one. I know. Anyway.
And then we'll have the audience questions, and
sure.
I think Sierra is monitoring the chat, so she can ask them out loud if people don't want to unmute.
Sure.
And we'll just be a little bit of a free for all. I have a call I have to be on upstairs at 11:30, so I'll probably end this a little bit early. But
I'll stay and hang out with
food and people. Yeah. And, so first question is, well, we're so glad to have you here, and thank you
for having me. I'm glad to be here.
And the first question is, how did you come to your work? Where does your passion come from?
Oh, wow. Wow. Okay. Well, I have to tell you about my new title, though, because I'm super excited about my new title. Because on July 1st, I am going to be named the holder of the endowed chair and lecturer in the health professions. And if anybody who knows anything about nursing education and why this is so important, I'm going to be the first Black person to hold this chair that used to be named the Elizabeth J. Sewell Endowed Professorship and Chair. Dean Sewell was the first founding dean of the University of Washington School of Nursing, which was the first school west of the Mississippi. And she notoriously did not allow for Black nurses to come to UW. So the Mary Mahoney Professional Nurses Association petitioned and petitioned and petitioned, and finally Black nurses were allowed to go to UW. And in her prescience, Dean Woods, former Emerita Dean Woods, went to the Regents along with Emerita Dean Imami Azita, and they got the professorship name changed. Because none of the family are still alive. And so they were able to right that wrong. And there was a public apology that happened in 2004 to the Mary Mahoney Professional Nurses Association for UW, barring Black nurses to study there. So it's fabulous sort of background. It actually works.
Right.
Mm-hmm. So that's going to be fun. Because it's the most prestigious and it's the most money that we have in our endowed professorships at the school. I was a preemie in 1969. If you know anything about history, yes, I'm 55. Well, I'll be 55. So. But if you know anything about history, It was after MLK was murdered. It was also after the AMA reluctantly decided to desegregate hospitals because they had to, because otherwise they wasn't going to get Medicare money. So I grew up in Jersey. And at that time, right, I'm from Trenton. I was there yesterday. I went to go see my parents. Mercer Medical Center, the hospital that I was born at, which no longer exists. And I worked at, that was the first hospital I ever worked at as a nurse in 1993. I actually should not be here because the infant mortality rate in New Jersey, which actually hasn't pushed much at all since I was born, was 32 per 1,000 births. So, and prematurity is the number one cause of infant mortality worldwide, right? So I was a real sick child. I spent more time with nurses than I did my parents. Mm-hmm. I was lucky that I could be at Children's Hospital in Philly, back and forth. And so when I was 8, I decided I was going to be a nurse. Now, this is despite the fact that nobody in my family was in healthcare. My mother was the first corporate vice president at Bank of America, Black woman. Because Core State's New Jersey National Bank, where she worked, was acquired by B of A. And then my dad, many of y'all know his work, because he co-started the Black Student Law Association at Penn. And he's a retired constitutional judge, and much of his work right now is being dismantled in the civil rights. And there's all of that equity, diversity, inclusion. But nobody was in healthcare. And I was like, I'm going to be a nurse. And they were like, seriously? And I was like, yes. I said, I spend more time with nurses than I do y'all. So when it came time for me to go to college, I applied to one, College of New Jersey, which I call Trenton State because that's where I went. But my dad went there and my sister went there as well. And got in, Garden State Scholar, studied nursing. It's the only thing I've ever done for pay as an adult. And to do it all over again, I would do it all over again. Contrary to popular belief, my master, I'm not a midwife, but I studied them on, I played one on TV. I spent a lot of time in midwifery because for a while I thought I wanted to be one. My master's is in public health. I took an epi course and fell in love. I was like, oh, these are my people. Yes. They were talking about populations, communities. And when I started my MPH, which is in community health education, I realized I needed to advance my education. So I did something crazy, which I don't advise students to do, but if they decide to do it, I'm not mad at them. I finished my MPH in May of 2002, and I started the PhD in September of 2002. I went straight through.
You like school.
I do. I'm a lifelong learner.
You like school, right?
I have only worked in reproductive health rights and justice, and I've only worked with childbearing families my entire career. Wow. So I started off in a oncology step-down unit that became a catch-all in med-surg. So we saw a lot of HIV patients. We saw a lot of post-surgery patients. But GYN oncology is actually my number one love. That's why my dissertation is in tumor markers and ovarian cancer, and I'm a laboratory-trained scientist. And but if you think about it, and this is where I get to geek out with a lot of cool colleagues, development is development. Right? The way, that, at least on an evolutionary biology perspective, right? Whether or not we get babies or tumors is socially determined, and how we treat them is socially, because they are both alive, right? So, like, when we think about, I want to write this incredible paper using gestational trophoblastic disease or molar pregnancy as a way to get people to think about the social construction of meaning, just like race, just like ethnicity. Yeah. So I think about that one.
All right. So you have a fantastic frame for change in which you talk about retrofit, reform, and reimagine. We love that. I use that all the time.
Yeah.
Could you briefly explain it and see how the parts work together to create more health equity, and how you advise people to find their area, whether they're in retrofit or they're in reimagine?
Yeah. So this came out of years of frustration. Because I realize, and this is why I also reject polarity when people always say, oh, the country's polarized and all that stuff. I reject all that. That actually is, in my mind, intellectually lazy. people were talking past each other. And this is like the reason that Repro is an exemplar for so many things, or we're ground zero for where a lot of stuff happens, is because reproduction isn't just about the propagation of the human species, right? It's about reproduction of ideas. It's reproduction of opportunities. It's reproduction of a whole variety of other things. But people, we've been trained to think that reproduction is just about propagation of our species or having babies. It's not. So when you talk, well, people use the same words, but they have different meanings. And so we think we're in conversation with people, but we're really not. Mm-hmm. So retrofitting, I spent 34 years in California, or 32 years in California before I moved to Seattle. And so retrofitting has a very specific definition. And that is you are trying to make changes or make supports or do something different, but the existing structure is going to remain the same. So when we retrofit buildings in California for earthquake safety, we don't blow the building up and build a new building, right? There is something that you're going to do, but the inherent structure is not going to change. So when I'm talking to students, the example I give them is like in healthcare, until we change how we pay for it, insurance has to, like, that's the thing that's not changing. Employer-sponsored health insurance is the number one way that people get health care in the United States. So everything else is just tinkering around the edges. Right? Until we change that in a capitalist system, right, there's some parameter, but then people be acting like, oh, we're going to transform like accountable payer organizations and this and that. And da-da-da. I'm like, right? Oh, that might make you feel good. You might build a career off of that, but that's not transformation, because we're not having the same organization. That's a retrofit, because you're not, the core is not free. Like, you know, reformation is tricky, right? Because the fundamental difference between reforming something and retrofitting something is, in reformation, you can do two things that you can't do in retrofitting. You can take some stuff off your plate, and you can actually change the inherent structure, right? But you're still not blowing it up, right? The core, the meaning, the purpose is still going to be. So the way I talk about like reformation is when I was working as like a birth San Francisco general, because the only clinical work I do right now is vaccines. I do COVID shots and flu shots, because that's all I've talked about. We went to Epic, and we had been on paper for years, right? So we get an electronic medical record. Y'all know we still had paper while we had the electronic medical record, right? Why did we do it? Because we didn't reform our practices that would allow for us to remove something. We wanted to double check. Ultimately, that transition occurred. But when you're trying to make change, you have to understand that reformation requires a both and, right? And a lot of times people just want to just flip the switch and we're going to go to the other. That's where another source of conflict. Reimagining is where a lot of people like to sit. We want to blow it up, burn it all down, start a fresh start on money. And I always tell people, I want to be team reimagined. But the problem with team reimagine is I'm a really good retrofitter. And if you're going to reimagine, or you want to blow it all up, you got to get your people out first. Like I say this all the time. It's like, okay, yeah, we can blow up academia, but what about the students? What about the patients? Where is the thing we're going to replace it with? And reimaginers drive me up a tree, because a lot of times that's a dream space. Mm-hmm. You could sit there and vision and dream all day and do absolutely nothing. How many meetings you go to and you think you're going to come out with some strategies or some skills or some tools, and you sat there dreaming, you feel really good, you'll walk out, nothing changes. I'm dead drives me up a tree, so I can't even bother. So I use this framework often. Once you teach it to people, and they understand where you're coming from, you can stop people in conversation, or when you're in groups with other humans, and you can say, are you retrofitting right now? Because what about this thing is not changing? Mm. So because I work in maternal child health, and I work in reproductive health rights and justice spectrum, what are we not making space for? Like in this current conversation, I spend a lot of time making people uncomfortable, because the Dobbs decision gave us, now people start to understand how repro is connected to everything else, because then we have to deal with EMTALA, and we have to deal with all the sort of subsequent sequelae, where a lot of people didn't understand that repro was actually the basis of things, and that wasn't changing.
And just say what EMTALA is.
Oh, right? Sorry. Not everyone. EMTALA is the emergency medical...
You can say the gist.
Yeah, I forget I'll think of it in a second, because it comes... EMTALA was a case or a law that was written in 1983, and it was enacted in 1984, signed into law by Ronald Reagan, that said that we could not dump patients, and patients had to be stabilized in emergent and in urgent settings, and then transferred to other levels of care, right? So we used to have a situation, this came out of a Supreme Court case like many do. It was a medical malfeasance case where Skid Row residents in Southern Los Angeles and the public defender's office ended up suing to allow that hospitals and ambulances couldn't just leave unstable people. Like, you couldn't just discharge people, not stabilize them and not treat them. And we've lived under the law of EMTALA for some time. I think, you know, regardless of ability to pay, regardless of whatever, there are federal qualifications that fall under EMTALA that we as healthcare professionals humanely and safely want to make sure that we can get people to the right and appropriate level of care, whatever is going on with them physiologically. And you can be punished by not having access to federal dollars if you're not going to follow the rules of EMTALA. Like, you can opt out of it, but you're just not going to have access to Medicare or Medicaid.
And so the reproductive situation, you were saying that's all related.
It's all related because the Idaho abortion case that is at the heart of striking at EMTALA is making an argument that people who are having miscarriages or people who potentially could be losing a pregnancy or so whatever around pregnancy, I'm going to talk about that in a minute. Clinicians and patients can be criminalized and sued depending on, like, how sick do you have to be in order to be able to be treated, basically, is the gist of that case, right? Do you have to almost be near death and dying in order for somebody to treat you when ending a pregnancy actually might save a person's life? One of our problems around this, and this is a little tangent, but I have to say this, because whenever I have an audience, I need people to understand that we have spent too much time studying the outcomes of pregnancy and not pregnancy in and of itself, right? So abortion, birth, miscarriage, surrogacy, infertility, these are all outcomes of pregnancy. Pregnancy is the condition, okay? So you've got people who built entire careers around an outcome, but we actually don't even understand the condition. So we don't know what starts like natural parturition. We think it's aging placenta. We got theories around why babies come when they come, but right. So there's that. So for me, retrofitting, reforming, and reimagining is a powerful tool to know in real time. And it's tied to health equity work. It's tied to anti-racism. It's a way to operationalize the self-scanning that we want people to do, the self-critique, the self-evaluation, right? If inherently, you know, our biases are going to cause humans to have errors, whether it's, you know, racial bias, whether it's medication, regardless of what it is, as humans, we're flawed and we're going to make mistakes and we're going to create an environment where that correction in real time can occur. You need a tool to be able to do that. That's better than fight, flight, or freeze, in my mind. So retrofit, reform, and reimagine actually helps us to do that because it gives you a pause to be able to say, okay, are we reimagining this here? And if so, who's being left behind? Is racism operating here? And if so, how? Right? It allows you to get very curious and ask different kinds of questions because a lot of times I think, and I don't know if this happens to y'all, but this happens to me a lot. My brain is functioning faster than my mouth is. And so I have to be listening to myself in real time to understand where to let my mouth catch up. And so that's really a tool where it came from. Cause I commit, like I would commit a lot of very public errors. I try to be I'd like to feel as spectacularly as I succeed in public. Cause it helps us to model the behavior of correction, right? My vulnerability is I make assumptions about people's gender. So my students have taught me to elicit, right? That's why I try to use they and y'all. And like, until I know better, I am trying to create and practice and simulate ways to do better. And so retrofit reform reimagine allows you to do that, because then you can articulate to somebody, you know, I'm still really reforming my inherent programming to see gender in a binary. And so I'm making assumptions based on your parents, my apologies. How would you like for me to refer to you? Or how would you like to be, you know, called? What name should I use for you, right? It helps you to correct yourself in real time. But the commitment actually is a retrofitting of saying, I am a human and I'm gonna own all of that humanity, including my ability to be wrong in public. And I'm going to humbly, or I'm gonna think about what works with my personality. I'm gonna retrofit pieces of my personality. And clearly I'm extroverted. I'm a pretty serious scientist, but I'm a hella goofy person, right? So I try to not, I want to be my most authentic self, both as a scientist, but also as a human. And retrofitting and reforming and reimagining allows me to do that and to articulate that work clearly.
Fantastic. I have two other questions, and then we can get audience questions. So get thinking about what you want to ask Dr. McLemore. Actually, it's three, but they're short. What do you see as some of the most hopeful efforts in nursing right now? And that could be in nursing practice, in education, in research, or organizationally.
In nursing specifically?
We could say health more broadly if you'd like, but I think either one.
Well, and this is going to seem trivial, but it's not. I am really glad that Halle Berry and Drew Barrymore talk about menopause. Sharon Malone's book is out. Like, I am really glad people are starting to talk about their authentic experiences of menopausal transition. And I say that because, again, if people thought abortion was stigmatizing, right? Let's talk about the senescence of desirability, ageism that's associated with the senescence of your reproductive capacity, right? I mean, this is, again, one of those other unintended consequences, because when Dobbs happened and we removed the protections of Roe in the United States, a lot of people in repro got really mad at me. I'm like, well, we have an opportunity to reimagine this, right? People forget Congress could fix this if they wanted to. If they wanted to pass the Women's Health Reproductive Health Protection Act, they could, right? So as citizens, we have to be thinking about what conversations are going to get people to actually be like, oh yeah, have the citizens in the country actually deserve to be able to decide how they want to exist? So for me, I am excited. And there are some nurses, you know, at the forefront of that. I'm glad to see, like, you know, oh, the First Lady is putting $100 million in sprints to women's health. And we've got ARPA coming down the pike. And all of a sudden, everybody is really interested about uterus having individuals. Okay, that's a retrofit. We should have been included in research and clinical trials before, like, 1976. But okay, here we are. How are we going to reimagine? I don't know. I have a love-hate relationship with academia and our institutions right now. So, but from a nursing perspective, the students, we keep admitting some pretty badass students.
Yes.
Many of them are here.
Right? I mean, they keep pushing us in ways that I'm not sure we as a profession were prepared for. So it's forcing us to reform many of our practices. Mm-hmm. Right? I'm excited about the shift film, right? Yes. We've got that was so incredible. So if y'all don't know, there's a documentary film that's coming out. It's called Shift. And I broke down in tears because when Chad told me that he named the film after something I said, so many nurses are featured in this movie talking about anti-racism, talking about equity, diversity, inclusion, talking about, you know, changing our profession. When he named it everybody's work, because that's something that I said, you know, some people think that the work of equity, diversity, inclusion is the work of equity, diversity, inclusion officers and people who hold positions. Because at that time, I was the interim dean, the associate dean for equity, diversity, inclusion at UW. I said, but it's everybody's work, right? And once we get to a point where we all appreciate that that's everybody's work, and it will be, inculcated or institutionalized within right. basic nursing education, not like it's some separate thing. So I think the students are helpful and hopeful because they're going to make us reform, mm-hmm. you know, and retrofit nursing mm-hmm. education.
Maybe reimagine.
And maybe. Yeah, I try to push them all the time to say, for the students in the room, every decision you make in the now changes the future. Mm-hmm. Just saying. And so, you know, as you think through, what are you going to do and what levers are you going to use and where you're going to be at, you know, like be thinking about this because this is something I'm thinking about. If we're disappointed with our options in terms of who wants to represent us in government, you know, Cori Bush and Lauren Underwood need some help. Who'd run for office besides me, right? I mean, we need to be thinking about, like, you know, Ernest Grant, past president, or, you know, ANA, he was talking about the, he knows nurses in NASA, and he, you know, nurses in space. We got nurses in the NFL. I mean, okay, we need nurses everywhere.
We need to say they used to be a nurse. We need to stop saying they used to be a nurse.
Oh, see, that's why I don't even say, I don't even deal with that. I don't even say that. I say to people all the time, I'm a nurse.
You never say someone used to be a lawyer.
Or just this. Or just. I want to eliminate those words from how we talk about ourselves. But again, that goes back to the supremacy of acute care institutions and our employers dictate and what they think nursing is rising.
Okay, my last questions, and then we'll turn it over to you all, is what's the best piece of advice you've been given, either in for overall life or for your work?
Okay, there's
so many that you can't boil them down. I'm
gonna give you an internal one that I developed that I live by to this day, and I'm gonna give you one from George Clooney.
Okay.
I told him, Jenna, shout out to the 80s. I'm hella goofy. Okay, so I figured out when I was in college, and I talked about Dr. Bond in one of the trailers for film. So my preceptors changed my life. Mm. We had a patient who, he was combative, he was horrible, he had swastikas on his arms, like it was a lot. And he was upper GI bleed and he had ang tube in, trying to put him on rest. And he kept pulling it out, he's meaning to nurses, everything. And so we were students on the unit and she said, nurses were giving a report. And Dr. Bone raised her hand and said, oh, Ms. McLemore and I will take him today. Looked at her, I was like,
for real?
We got into medics, cardex, see, I'm that old. And then we go into the thing. And I said, Dr. Palm, why are we taking him? And she was like, look, she said, Ms. McLemore, you're one of my smartest. She used to call us by Ms. She's a very formal person, that's why I still call deans next dean, because that's a sign of reverence and respect. But she was like, Ms. McLemore, you are one of my strongest nursing students. Look around you. These nurses are tired. They're beat down. They're frustrated. Nobody wants him as an assignment today. We are guests and visitors here. If we take good care of him today, we've taken good care of them today. Mm-hmm. So I went home and journaled that evening after I got home because I was tired as hell because he was a lot. And we shaved him. We gave him a bath, all of that. Mm-hmm. He pulled his injury tube that we advocated for 2 hours so he could get ice chips just to see if it mm-hmm. worked. You know, they didn't put it back in. Like, all of that. Like, it was a lot. And I learned a huge lesson that day and that from her, and that is you have to live up to your own expectations mm. in your own mind of the kind of person you want to be. And I was willing to not want to take care of this man because, you know, when I say combative, I'm using N-word, being crazy, like, I mean, swastikas on, like all that. I learned the essence of the person that day. Mm-hmm. But I kept thinking, I was like, why is this okay? And I said, because you want to live up to your expectation mm-hmm. in your own mind. Like, we were just talking about this earlier. If I do a policy fellowship or whatever, when I'm getting ready to run for office, it would be great to go be in office with, like, a Republican who does not believe in reproductive. Because I believe that powerfully in the skills that nursing has taught me. Mm-hmm. I'm not trying to change their belief, I'm trying to change their actions.
Yes.
Right? So, and I think we are clever enough, brilliant enough, amazing enough, creative enough to be able to do that. What is the power of nursing education? Liberal arts, baccalaureate, nursing education. So that's my interim. Y'all remember when George Clooney was in a movie with Ice Cube and Mark Wahlberg? It's called Three Kings. They was then in the first Iraq War. Okay. At one point, George Clooney said, at some point, his character, I don't even remember his name. His character said, at some in your life, you have to do the shit, that's, the stuff that scares you shitless and worry about courage later. Mm-hmm. And I was like, wait, say that again. I had to rewind it because it was on the tape. Right. Remember Blockbuster? Okay. Yeah, he said, at some point, you have to do the stuff that scares you shitless. I worry about courage later. So working in repro, being on abortion-related billboards as a preaching your assistant professor to support Javier Becerra, who was arguing NIFLA versus Becerra in front of the Supreme Court, and everybody told me I was going to ruin my academic career. And I was like, maybe, so be it, but that's the right thing to do. Mm-hmm. His wife is a high-risk OB. I trained her when she was at UCSF. She's been at Santa Clara Valley Medical Center forever, taking care of, you know, Latine, immigrant, and Black patients, you know, at the public hospital. It was the right thing to do. I said, oh, that's going to ruin my nursing career. And then clearly the kind of academic nursing career that I imagine in my head doesn't exist. Mm.
Well, thank you. Well, thank you. Just here's a medium clap.
Thank you for having me. Thank you for hanging out with y'all. If you ask me a question or have a comment, tell me your name and your pronouns, please, so I know how to appropriately address you.
So we'll start in the room, and people on Zoom, start coming up with your questions as well. So anyone in the room?
Don't want to know. Hi, tell me your name and your pronouns.
There's good microphones, so okay. Do whatever you want.
I'm Brenda Nettles. I'm
Wait, say it again.
Brenda. My name is Brenda Nettles. Okay. I'm a nurse practitioner, and I really appreciate you coming to share your life experiences, what you've done in your career. I am an institutionalized former surgical nurse for many years, and I spent my whole career retrofitting things to make it work for the structures of the confines of a hospital. How do you recommend we begin to reimagine what could be for our specialty, our expertise that we want to see now grow, now that I'm living in a work academia, to be able to make it fruitful and prosper?
And when you say surgical specialties, are you talking like open heart surgery? Are you talking
I was a surgical oncology nurse practitioner for the last 17 years.
Got it.
And before that, I was a cardiac open heart transplant nurse.
Got it.
So I've always worked in acuity areas.
Wonderful. Well, first of all, thank you for that work. We've been so disrespected as members of the health profession, you know, from COVID, that I feel like we don't do enough gratitude. Plus, it's like national nurses, like the whole situation and all that. But thank you for that work. One thing I didn't say when I was talking about retrofit, reform, and reimagine is it's not linear. It's a circle. Mm-hmm. And we all can't be in the same one at the same time. The magic of being able to to your point, there's got to be retrofitters because the people who are currently in our institutions or in our spaces, we can't abandon them, right? So if that's a universal value, that we're not going to abandon anybody, we're not going to leave anybody, but like no child, we ain't leaving nobody behind, right? Then some people are going to have to be retrofitters to help make that lived experience humane, right? And we nurses are the people to do that. If you're going to reimagine it, though, everybody can't be reimagining because some people got to be retrofitted. But then the people who hold power have to be the reformers. Mm. They have to be, we can't deprive them of their opportunity to be courageous, right? So I had to say this, we were talking, I was the only, well, until the June 1st, I'm the only nurse ethicist on the ACOG, American College of Obstetrics and Gynecology Ethics Committee, right? And I said to them, I said, why are you all depriving people of the opportunity within ACOG to be courageous? We have a very harmful statement out right now about adoption. It's been in press or in print for the last 5 years and has all sorts of stuff like around, oh, we should be able to adopt foster children. That's the whole purpose of the foster system. All this is like, it's like family separation, but on the state sanctioned side. Anyway, I said, so we should retrofit that, like, is pulling that down more harmful and having no statement more harmful than leaving it up? I said, if we don't have the authority to make that decision, then people who hold power should reform that. So in your organization and institution, given all the expertise that you have in the surgical specialties, you know, are you got to decide, are you going to be a retrofitter to be there? And are you going to activate a learner, a student, or a early career nurse to run off and go dream about what that reimagination could look like? Is that specialty centers that are nurse-led? We think about that all the time. Like, I mean, unfortunately, the healthcare clinics within Walmart just closed, right? And we're trying to have pharmacies within Amazon. What's the innovation that needs, what is that innovation? Is that in your mind and that is stuff you thought about? Or can you transmit that to an early career person? Or can you amplify an early career person who got some crazy idea, but somebody's still got to hold it down? Mm-hmm. And I think in too many times, when we saw this mass exodus after George Floyd was murdered, people were starting, you know, advancing health equity and doing consultant work and all this other stuff to try and retrofit health care or to reform health care. But nobody reimagined it. Because nobody was given the space or the human, the money, the space, the time, the reputational resources to do that. Are there reparations that we need within the surgical specialties to really build them out in ambulatory ways that are not inhumane? Or like fly by night and hope you're going to be stable enough to go home. Is there ways to link that back to home visiting or the lessons that you can learn from repro, right? Where we're retrofitting emergency departments, we're retrofitting home visiting, nurse family partnership, all of that to better understand the signs and symptoms of deterioration so we can reduce maternal morbidity and mortality, because we know that, like, you know, half those cases happen in the postpartum period. But if people going to put their eyes on them are the home visitors, that's emergency nurses. It's not the L&D people. And yet we've concentrated our resources to the L&D nurses around those problems. Right? So thinking through the surgical specialties and the work that you do, is it discharge planning? Is it home? Is it who is going to hold the reimagination? And who's going to be the recruiters? That's how I would think. Is that helping?
It does, yeah.
I'm going to give you my contact.
Is there a someone said there was a hand up. I'm not going to be doing a very good job.
I see something in the chat too.
Yeah.
So hey, can folks unmute or what are we doing?
She has it back here.
We have the chat.
Okay.
Oh, you've got the chat. Okay.
Okay. All right. Maybe they just shout out.
Maybe they say,
Catherine, did you some emojis?
Yeah. Hi. Hi. Catherine Ling, she, her, hers. I am an FMP.
Yes.
I'm working in community. I have to admit, I'm a huge Twitter fangirl.
You was mad when I left?
Yeah, we all mad that you left.
Them Nazis Boston trolls, y'all. I get active incredible death threats, right? So the idea of, and I was mad because I, if y'all don't know me, probably what, 50, 60,000 followers on Twitter, right?
Yes.
And I spent years building out that audience. I was one of the early, so I'm an early adopter to technology. Mm-hmm. I was in San Francisco in the Bay Area when Twitter launched. I got my account, 2009, I think. So I've been a long-term Twitter user. And it broke my heart to leave. But I was in Jamaica. I usually go to warm places in December because my dissertation defense anniversary is on December 14th. And you got Christmas. I'm a heathen who loves holidays. And then my birthday is on New Year's Eve. So December, I do my thing. I was on the beach in Jamaica, and I had gotten one of the most hateful DMs on Twitter. And I have all the filters, all of stuff. I just think, you know what? This is a choice. I can choose differently. I left. I downloaded my archive, and it took 3 days. And then I left.
Well, my question is, one, where can I follow you? Because I find your voice incredibly powerful, and I miss the way you make everyone think.
I miss Twitter. I'm myself everywhere. So I'm McLemore MR on Threads, on Facebook, on Instagram, on LinkedIn, on YouTube, I like all the other platforms. Mm-hmm. I'm myself. And there's a reason for that. So one of the reasons, this is where repro is so prescient. Misinformation and disinformation run rampant for many reasons, right? But one of them is, if Nazis, bots, and trolls, these are tools, right? So if Nazis, bots, and trolls are the only people that's using them, what do we expect, right? If our work is behind firewalls or paywalls, I mean, this one, I've been waving so many, and I know the Mary Labor people are mad at me, But health equity, I've been waiving so many of the charges for to publish your papers because I have editorial authority to do that when people ask. Is because if the public can't freely access our content, how are you going to combat the misinformation and the disinformation, right? So one of the things that I have been doing is pushing journal editors to be able to have, whether it's 20 articles or if they've been in publication for a bit, to pull together special issues that are freely available to people for a set amount of time, right? Changing up the business model so we can still make our money, but then and pay the copyright and all the editorial staff, but then also still make that content freely available to people. I tell you all the scientists, depending on what your license is or where you decide to publish or where, so I used to do tweet threads. And I would always either take, I tell early career people to do this too, either take your tables or your figures, not your words, and explain that to the public like you'd be talking to your mom. Tell them what it means. I would do long threads in repro. Okay, no, that's a lie. We've been sold a lie around this. That language is actually very stigmatized, and that's all been sold to you by a campaign in Roe. Well, Roe's over. So let's have a different conversation about reproductive justice and what language we can use. Let's have a different conversation than about, and let's not just adopt language that has been purposively designed to create a false binary. So that's the kind of public education. But I saw that, and this is where we fell down in nursing, right? And I attribute this to our professional organization. We told nurses what not, how not to use social media. We didn't tell them how to use it as a tool. Because tools inherently, in my opinion, are agnostic. Mm-hmm. But they need rules, and we never had them. Like, everybody adopted social media, and everybody has their own internal compass, right? You got some people who only check certain stuff. Some people only friend family. Some people who are private in all these little groups. But nobody ever clearly articulated the rules of engagement. So you got this free-for-all, right? That's not being guided by our institutes. It's not guided by church. Not guided by civic conversation. Not guided by academic institutions. So you have a whole situation that's chaotic. I love it. Because again, I'm a Gen X child of the 80s. So this makes sense to me, right? But for other people, and some people are evil, and so they want to use it to create harm. Some people like randomness and chaos. Some people are very extroverted. Some people are introverted. Like, you're watching all of that play out in real time. I think it's fascinating.
I'd want to hold the floor for any students or postdocs who maybe feel nervous to ask a question, but we'll just be silent here for a moment and see if anything bubbles up for any of you. Yeah, go ahead, Amy.
Hi. Excuse me. My name is Amy. I use she, her pronouns. I'm a second year PhD student here. I also, the framework with the retrofitting, reforming and reimagining really resonated with me. And I know that you asked about it as well, but I think just for clarity, I know there's a clear difference with the retrofitting and reimagination. Can you talk a little bit more about the reformation piece?
Yeah.
Like, kind of the nuance of the difference between that and the retrofitting and where you see some of the levers for reformation.
Yeah, so the fundamental difference between reformation and retrofitting is something's not going to change when you're retrofitting, right? I mean, or if it's going to change, it's going to change very slowly. So when we, another example that I give outside of just health insurance, let's make it more about nursing, right? Men in nursing have been increasing in numbers over time, and they have actively been participating in leadership and roles and doing a variety of things, trying to elevate their positionality within what historically has been a female dominated profession, right? Or a very gendered profession. That's going to change. At some point, that's going to not be a thing because the genderedness of our profession, I hope, goes away, right? So the reformation of that, part of what leaders can be doing is making sure that there are opportunities that men in nursing as an underrepresented group can have access to mentorship, have access to, you know, things that help with their acculturation within the profession as it exists now, but then their acculturation in the profession as we reimagine it. So the difference is that that will change over time. It's not immutable. Whereas when you're retrofitting something, like unless we get single payer or some other kind of way we pay for healthcare in the United States, we spend a lot of time tinkering around the edges when that human money space, reputational resources could be directed at something else. So if I see another initiative around, like the AC is a perfect example of this. We keep tweaking that because that works. Right. And at some point, I think we're going to get to a place where we're going to have a whole, like a constellation of baseline things that everybody can expect, irrespective of who's paying for insurance. Right. Because at some point, we'll have a conversation that the evidence will bear out that we already know that insurance is the number one intervention to improve health outcomes at the population level, having access to care. Right. So the way I think about the fundamental difference is most reformers also have access to serious power. When I say serious power, they can either move humans or they can move money or they can allocate space or they can control how people's time gets spent. So, you know what the number two, or let me tell you what the top two things, if we wanted to really improve health outcomes at a population level in the United States, you know what those two interventions are because neither of them are in healthcare. Anybody know what they are? Actually, it's three.
Housing.
Basic minimum income. If we gave ourselves this basic minimum income, right? Number one, because we won't have to do that anyway at some point, but when our AI overlords take over. And we have a whole conversation about that mess. Okay. If we gave everybody, if we cancel student loan debt, and this is why people won't do it. If we cancel student loan debt, how many people would be doing different jobs? How many people would create different things? How many people would not be beholden to their employers if we canceled student debt? I went to public school. I have 3 degrees from public schools, right? I went to school at a time when taxpayers thought it was important to pay for public education. So the third intervention, if we wanted to improve population health, we would have high quality, low cost, 24-hour available childcare. If we had that, shift work would go away. Right. I'm just saying, if we're real serious, like that's a reimaginer kind of way to think, right? Because we don't have paid family leave, right? There are these big sort of reimaginer things, but at an institutional level, we're watching this play out where in some places, if you're lucky enough to work somewhere, right? This is Serena's husband. He's been all about this. He's been clear that people in tech shouldn't be the only place where you have paid family leave or where co-parents can be able to have the same amount of time that the pregnant uterus having person had or the surgeon had. Right? We can disrupt those kinds, but you got to have a certain amount of power to be a reformer. Retrofitting, we can continue to me, that was what a lot of like PDSA and evidence-based practice projects was. We're gonna tweak around QI, like we go, because that structure not changing, right? That can, and it feels very satisfying and gratifying to do that work. And that's important work, that's small scale. Reformers can actually retrofit at scale and they can change the structure. Is that more clarifying? Okay.
Great, great answer. Kamala, did you want to say something?
No, the students. What y'all got? Dr. Alexander? Hey! We can just say hey, because hey, I'm glad to see you.
We know you.
Happy McDonald's.
I was going to push back on the gender conversation.
Yeah, please do.
Push back.
Well, I would love to. I mean, I haven't thought it all the way through, but I would love to have a conversation about how having more men in nursing has improved.
Oh, I didn't say that.
I know. The reformation that you're saying is coming with a non-gendered profession implies that it's going to be that.
Yeah.
So let's talk about that.
Yeah, I mean, I and it's complicated, and I appreciate the conversation because this is going to be half big. But in my mind, there's some behaviors that I think are tied to socialization of gender or the performance of gender that are not healthy. One of them is the capacity or the skills that we need around financial literacy, the comfort of talking about money, especially in a job and negotiating perspective, right? And so for me, you know, if we could get to gender pay equity, then the gender piece of the caring professions might change. Mm-hmm. So it's not necessarily the men in nursing piece, it's the gendered ways in which we've been socialized around the ways, the relationships that we have with our employers. Is that?
Yes. So then if we are reforming the profession, how are we actively dismantling the structures that do not allow pay equity to be in the conversation while we see the entry of the male-bodied person into the profession and continuing to move into leadership mm-hmm. and gain more access to status?
Yeah, I don't think that's the path. I actually think labor unions do a better job of this, right? I mean, labor unions, irrespective of what your gender is, they negotiate for the discipline and the profession, right? Not for the gender of whoever is in it. So this is where I think we have something to learn from staff nurses, because there is a collective agreement about what we want and need, irrespective of what your gender is, right? So, but I also think that there is a place where, as we normalize a variety of gendered people within a discipline or a profession, we can then have a very painful conversation about the people who prop up patriarchy within nursing, who taking it away from men, really making it about the patriarchal notions of who's worthy to serve as a member of the health professions and what our admissions criteria look like and what our clinical rotations are, and why can't we accommodate parents? Like, there's a whole variety of things that get regendered in how we provide nursing education. So it's a complex conversation that I think we have to have, but there are people in our discipline and our profession who don't even want to have the conversation. And that's where I think the reforming needs to happen. That's where I think the pushing sometimes, or the discomfort that people feel. There's an unpopular conversation that happens. Oh, well, men get to move up in nursing because men dominate, whatever. They, you know, they are a minoritized group within our discipline. So, wow, here are the men. Like, I have mentors who say things like this. And I was like, okay, then maybe let's have a different conversation about what leadership in nursing should look like and what skill set that's associated with that. And then let's have parity across leadership, i.e. let's stop accepting that people who join the professoriate are just by nature going to have a pay cut, because we have figured out how to be able to maintain clinical salary within an academic institution. That's the actual conversation nobody wants to have, right? So for me, it's gender, like race, is a proxy for not having the actual conversations that we should actually mm-hmm. be having.
So I'm going to, I need you to wait in just a second, but Kathy McDonald had her hand up earlier.
We're going to talk about this. We're going to keep talking about this.
Yeah.
And there's a hand in the back too.
Yeah. Kathy McDonald has a question or a comment, and we have two comments in the chat as well.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. Will you finish out the moderating? Okay.
Come on, baby Lord. I'm just
become a moderator.
Nah. Well, you were so good at it on Friday. Oh, come on,
can I have an Usy before you go?
Mm-hmm.
Monica, we're going to get an Usy with the group.
Oh, Usy. Oh, yeah.
Well, mm-hmm. It should be with everyone. Yeah.
I know. Okay. All right. So everybody's responsible for their own faces here. All right. 1, 2, 3.
Okay.
Because you need it for the grant.
Yeah.
Because the public needs to know we have a ball. We geek out. We talk, we have difficult conversation. We need to model this behavior for the public. That's why they're, and I know that they're colleagues and collaborators on here who are not even affiliated because we posted the link live. Yes. I mean, one of my good friends from, one of my sorority sisters is on here from South Carolina, who is a BA nurse, baccalaureate. I'm trying to push her to advance her education. Method to my madness. Dr. McDonald was going to ask me something, right?
Yeah.
Hey,
I see you. Hi. Hey. I'm Kathy McDonald. I'm a professor here, and I'm not a nurse, but I'm very focused on patients and frontline in my sort of social science and system science approach, and just always honored to be part of, you know, anybody who cares about patients. And it seems like nurses are, you know, very close in scientifically and with the holistic view. So that's where I come from. And I'm just so inspired by your work and so pleased to be able to hear you directly. I'm very interested, and I suspect others might be interested in where you would think about retrofitting, reimagining, and reforming research and funding of research. I know that's a huge question, but it's, you know, it's,
yes, it's
whatever you want to throw our way that we could be part of the bandwagon for whatever you think, I think would be wonderful to hear a top whatever.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. So part of the reason I'm in town is I'm trying to decide what I'm going to do next in my life, right? I applied to be the intramural director of the National Institutes of Nursing Research, and I can't go have a call. I was supposed to see Janice Zank, who is the director of NINER, tomorrow for coffee, but I'm actually going to go up to New Jersey and see my high school friend, best friend from actually third grade, but we'll see. They say they want an innovative and bold thinker and director. We'll see.
They're really ready.
And I applied for one of the, for the maternal child health people in the room. I know many of y'all are in DC and I'm going to come join y'all later, but, PCORI dropped last Friday a new program officer for comparative effectiveness research, and maternal child health was one of the foci of people. So I applied for that. I look, being a funder, like I've bitched and complained about funders a good amount of my career. I published a whole ass article that a lot of people cite in Health Equity before I was the editor. Funders are part of the problem. So we need to go reimagine, right? In my mind, we would rework, and there's some people internally that are doing this. I'm on the National Academies of Science, Engineering, and Medicine, new standing committee on reproductive health, equity, and society. And Allison Chernish and a whole lot of Wanda Barfield, there's a lot of people who are trying to reimagine the federal funders, right? HRSA, CDC, PCORI, NIH. Part of the problem is they carve us up by our body parts, right? You got institutes that don't even talk to each other. So they have all these intramural initiatives, and the Improve Initiative is one of them, where they are trying to use the general fund to be able to acknowledge that carving folks up in their disease. And I just want us to call that what it is. That's why I hate the fact that like federal funding is the coin of the realm and everybody loves it. It's like this perverse incentive because the indirect. But it's more we use that to build careers for people. Some of the science is actually really good, but the truth of the matter is it is one of these situations where that's why I like sort of the ARPA approach. I've known many engineers who've done work through DARPA, but the funders are part of the problem, right? I know so many learners who learn how to write great grants, but they don't have good ideas. Drives me up a tree. We need to start funding just some change makers. Mm-hmm. We need to fund some incubators and accelerators. We need to change how we fund science, right? I say this all the time. Nursing is shared, where had we brought nursing to academia instead of the other way around, we would have figured out, just like a lot of the genome scientists did. You saw they pushed an entire institution, got data use agreements. You know where those came from, right? There was a thinking of people who came together and said that if we are going to have a public and a private race to map the human genome, what's the ethics behind doing that when we still need to have basic scientists build their careers? But we ask in hundreds of thousands of labs around the country to contribute to this effort. They figured out group science and how to get people past dissertations and all of it and get unique individual credit in groups. Who's been doing that work forever? nursing, right? So in my mind, we could boldly rethink as an institute how to, especially when not everybody funded by NINER are actually even nurses. That's a whole other conversation, right? But like, how could we really restructure the funding scientific enterprise? And I'm trying to push a whole lot of private philanthropy to be able to do this too. Cause I always tell people, despite my $13.2 million portfolio that I've had as a researcher, I have never had federal funding. I've applied to PCORI 5 times. I have applied to NIH 4 times. I have never had, my learners have, right? I've gotten Eugene Washington engagement awards and K's and all this other stuff. I have never, none of my ideas have ever been funded federally. And that's why I call bullshit on funders, because they don't fund the best science. For years, they didn't fund repro cell. And that's where we sacrifice epistemological diversity, right? You can't just study stuff that's fundable. That's the problem. So in my mind, that's where philanthropy, you know, comes into play. I mean, I walked up, there were some people, well, none of y'all, maybe some people online. I walked up to Rich Besser, who is the president of Robert Wood Johnson. You was there. I walked up to him right in front of 300 people at a conference. I was like, hey, Rich, how you doing? Because I've known him for you. Hey, how you doing? He's like, hey, man, it's good to see you. I said, you know, I'm gonna need your job.
Straight out like that. Dr. McLemore, you don't have to bring you in. We got 1 minute left.
Y'all got work to do. I thought we was having lunch. I thought we was hanging out.
Yeah, for the event. But I do want to ask you this question here for the record. Like, given our institution and the status that allows us to have a certain influence within nursing, because we are the number one nursing school in the country, what is your charge to us? Like, what do you feel like is our responsibility in kind of leading in nursing, if you will?
Well, I'm gonna tell you exactly what I told the people at Kaiser Permanente. And full disclosure, my sister is an adjunct professor here. I'm not the first Dr. McLemore in my family. She is actually tenured at Morgan State University, which is a historically Black college and university downstream. Kaiser Permanente has the lowest preterm birth rates almost in the country. And I'm like, oh, so I guess that abdicates your responsibility to help the rest of us out. Right? Oh, you good here. So I guess everybody else is just screwed. Right? When you sit in a position of power and you have good outcomes, you're doing something really well, right? Don't abdicate the responsibility to help the collective. What partnerships do we need? I told them they need to expand their Division of Research Fellows program, right? Let new learners come in, see your data, and really start to reimagine what's possible at their institution. Or if you're going to constantly allow for the training burden to fall on public institutions and public hospitals who have the sickest patients, thank you for coming, then how are you helping? How are you helping to lift that load? Right? Or do you even think that that's your job? Who are the research collaborators that you're working with that have access to those groups or those communities? How can we be of service? Right? Nursing is about service. How can we be of service? That's why I hate, Gloria Steinem once, I'm gonna end on this. Gloria Steinem once said, how much would humanity be different if we considered ourselves linked and not ranked? What would we do differently if we were linked and not ranked? Mic drop.
Literally.
That's my mind. That's Gloria Steinem. I'm just saying. I had the opportunity to meet her and Faye Waddleton, the first Black woman to ever lead Planned Parenthood. Dr. Bond introduced me to her. I nearly fell over.
I think we're all falling over. Thank you.
Thank you for having me. I'm going to be here. My training's not until like month. Hang on, give me some lead. Thank you for being here on Zoom. I said, I'll be back. Love y'all.